as a voice cries out in the silence, searching for a heart that will love him, longing for a child that will give him that will give it all. He wants it all. And there's a God that walks over the earth. He's searching for a heart that is desperate and longing for a child that will give him that all, give it all.
Verses out of that. Father, I do thank you for your word tonight. I thank you for the presence and the power of your spirit. I thank you that you have circumcised our ears to hear what the Holy Ghost is saying to the church. I pray that your word will go forth like a mighty burning fire, and that it would consume us, that it would transform us and conform us to the image and the likeness of your dear Son. We give you praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to turn real quick, Genesis 1 and 2. I think I have about 7 more minutes. Is that all right?
Amen.
The word of God says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said, someone say, God said, let there be light, and there was light. We're going to talk very briefly this evening about the alchemy of your prophetic word. Someone say the alchemy, of your prophetic word. Alchemy is designed as a power or process of transforming something common into something special. It is an inexplicable or mysterious transmuting or conversion or transformation. God has a special communications media that is more advanced than any technology on the face of the earth. The mere fact that society has advanced to the point that it has but an inkling of the colossal impact his agents, both spiritual and natural, have had on the world, whether the masses choose to believe in him or not. Long before we had radio and television and theater and plasma and LCDs, God had his methods of communicating and painting pictures that are worth more than 1,000 words. Before this concept of a satellite or satellite communication was even a thought in Arthur C. Clarke's mind, before the launching of the Sputnik, God had proved that he had the ability to communicate and that his communications media was fully functional and operative in all of his worlds. God engineered a system of data transmission that spanned everything that existed both eternally and temporarily, ethereally and cosmologically, as well as spiritually and naturally. In his omniscience, his all-knowingness, and his omnipotence, he knew that he had to create and implement a way for all of his worlds to interact, engage, and coexist with each other. Stay with me, I'm going somewhere. Prophecy is the tool that causes those transactions to occur and to manifest all of God's original purpose and intent for them. In the 21st century, we have an understanding of the prophetic that has really paled in comparison to meet God's standard of what the prophetic is. We talked a little bit about prophets that have had $1,000 lines and they prophesy things. You know, you sow this amount and I'm going to prophesy this for the next 12 months. If you give me this much, I'm going to prophesy for the next 3 months. And then they're basically just telling you things that you want to hear, things that are tickling your ears, things that are already in your heart. But when it comes to really understanding and walking in God's purpose for the prophetic, they have failed in their commission. God's design of his prophetic agency is not that it's going to tell you just things that are to come. God's design for the prophetic is that it is a medium, it is a mold, it is a transportation vehicle that takes eternal matter and brings it into the natural world so that it can manifest. So when a prophet that is a true prophet of the Lord comes to you to prophesy, it's not that they're just reading your ticket or reading your mail or telling you something in 6 months you're going to be okay. The words of that prophet literally put in motion what it's going to take for the fulfillment of God's word to be done in your life. I like to say that prophets read the DNA codes of creation and they see, because they have an ability to see into that world and into that realm, they see God's blueprint, they see his strategy, they see his purpose, and then they unlock that through the anointing of the prophetic and bring it here and make it tangible so that you can live out your divine destiny. In Ezekiel 13, the prophet Ezekiel was dealing with, and you don't have to turn there for interest of time, but he was dealing with prophets that were true prophets in Israel, but they were prophesying falsely. They were prophets that were prophesying lies and vain visions and divinations that did not come from the Lord. And the reason why there was such a sentence against them was because they did not stand in the gap to build a wall for the house of Israel to stand. So they were prophets that had a gift of prophecy, or they had functional prophetic operation, but they did not stand in the counsel of the living God. So to be a prophet or to walk in the prophetic or to deal with God in receiving a true prophetic word, you first have to be the type of vessel that stands in the counsel of the living God. I don't want to hear nothing about you paid $300 and you went to the prophetic class and they activated you and they tested out your prophecy. No, I need to know, when's the last time you went on a 3-day fast and your face was to the ground in the presence of the living God? When you contact, or when you come into contact with a prophet that has stood in the face of God, and God has apprehended that prophet to be his mouthpiece. I don't mean you just have a good gift of discernment. That's right. I don't mean you have dreams that come to pass consistently. I mean God himself has said, you are the one that if I choose to do something in the earth, I'm not going to do it unless I reveal my secret to you. When you get that type of vessel that has that type of command and that type of connection with God, then you are about to hear a prophetic word that's going to change your life. Amen. We're talking about the alchemy of your prophetic word. So in our generation, we've not seen prophets on a wide scale that have stood in the counsel of the Lord. We've not seen prophets that have taken and undertaken the burden of God for the nation. We've not seen prophets that have rallied the people of God together to pray and to intercede and to fast so that God can relent from his judgments in the earth. We've seen people that have tapped into psychic and occultic activity so that they can read your name, read your mail, tell you your address, and then take you for everything that you got. In this day of restoration, reformation, and realignment, God is saturating the earth, Aaron, with apostles and prophets that have been on the backside of the desert. They've had everything stripped from them. They've lost everything. They've come to a place of death to themselves where they say, God, if your breath does not move in my body, I can't even wake up or move or walk to the left or to the right. They said, God, I have no agenda because the fires in my life have ridden me of anything that is self-promoting or self-centered. These are people that have been under the hand of God. They've been broken. They've been conformed. They've been converted. They've been pressed upon. They've been mashed upon. And God has finally got them to the place where they are ready to be presented to the world. And he knows that they're not going to fail in their commission, because he's tested their hearts.
We're birthing the plan. We're birthing the vision. We're birthing the purposes of God for an entire region tonight. Father, we release an apostolic sound in the region tonight.
There are spiritual portals and doors that are opening and closing. And if we are not moving with the Spirit, we are going to miss the divine shift that's meant to connect us to the place of our destiny. See, when a prophet prophesies the word of the Lord, it creates an opening in the heaven that gives you the opportunity and the ability to step into another dimension, to step into another place. When the woman of God or when a man of God or the prophet comes and prophesies that this is the season for your ministry, it's the season to go forth. You don't go home and call everybody on Facebook and Twitter that I just got another word. You get on your face and you prepare your life for the shift that's about to take place. We get more excited over the fact that we heard a prophetic word than we are motivated to do what the word demands. Yes. And then we miss a season. Well, God, why is this happening for her? Why is this over here happening for him? Because when they heard the word, they put faith to the word and they acted on it. So those agents that were sent to bring that word to pass in the earth are working, and they're causing everything to come to pass for them. Your angels are somewhere tied up, waiting for you to get in obedience. God created you in him before the foundation of the world. And within you are all the spiritual properties of his godliness, his destiny, his purpose. And then he breathed you out of him. He sent you into the earth, power packed and full with everything you were going to need to be a success. The job that you need. The ministry that you have to give birth to. The gift and the calling of God is locked up inside of you, and you don't have to look anywhere else to get that to be opened up. It's in you. So when you sit under leadership, when you sit under an anointing, when you sit under the mantle of an apostle, that means that there is an igniting of that divine purpose. There is no reason why in an apostolic house everybody isn't trying to own a business. There's no reason in an apostolic house that everybody isn't in a posture where they can minister to the sick or minister deliverance. Amen. The least of anybody in an apostolic house should at least be casting devils out, because that's promised to every believer. God told me, he said, jar them. He said, shift the mindset and make them move into another place. Because in the spirit, I'm going to tell you what I see. Can I tell you what I see? And I'm almost done. How many? I got 3 more minutes. I see the woman of God. And I see her working. And I see the weight of the ministry upon her shoulders. I see it. And she's carrying the vision. And she's aware of this and aware of that. And she has delegates and she has people that are assigned to do things. I met with her and talked with her, so I understand a little bit of her flow. But, somebody say but.
But
I see her carrying a load that needs to be transferred and imparted to the people that are under her. That didn't go over very well, sir. Did you notice that? I got like 2 amens. Did you see that? There is a weight of leadership that she's carrying. And it has been great for these seasons that you've been in. It has been great for the time up until now. But there is a shift that's about to take place in her ministry. There is a shift. Listen, y'all listening? There's a shift that's about to take place. And if you don't want to get caught outside of the shift, it means that you got to ante up and you got to be in your position to shoulder the weight of everything that you can possibly shoulder.
Amen.
See, there's too much of her having to come behind people to make sure they did it the right way. There's too much looking and checking and trying to, okay, well, I told you to do it like this. Okay, baby, better next time. Okay, but you've been baby better next time for 4 years now. I saw as I sat in the seat, the nations beginning to open for this woman of God. I saw them. I saw her dressed in African attire, and I saw her taking a team of people on a mission trip overseas. But guess what? That season is coming, and it's going to be right on schedule. So for everybody else that is not at the appointed place at the appointed time, what is going to become of you? Because when God opens that portal, she has to walk through that door. Now, as a pastor, she's not going to leave the church, but the church will suffer if the people that are left behind are not in the right place, in the right position, when she has to walk through that portal.
We release a prophetic sound in the region tonight. We open up the heavens over this territory, and we release the sound of the Lord. Shata.
God said that this church is moving into a season of elevation. Shifts are about to happen. I saw it even in the leadership. She's been mapping out changes that need to be done. She's been looking at God. How can I improve my effectivity here? How can I tighten things here? How can I change things in this aspect of the leadership? How can I get this program? All of these things are going in her mind because God is preparing her to take on the next leg of the race. He's preparing her to attain to the next section of the blueprint that has been written concerning her life.
Amen.
So where does that leave you? It leaves you now in the place where the responsibility of living up to the expectation of the prophetic word that's been spoken over your life is now off of her and it's on you. The weight of your prophecy is on your shoulder because God has already sent the word. He's already told you what he's going to do with you. He's already told you what you're gifted and called to do. He's already told you how you need to function in the house. Now it's time, according to the Spirit of God, according to the timetable of God, this Kairos moment right now, it's time to put up. I'm not going to say put up or shut up. It's just time to put up. It's time for every joint to supply their need because God has need of you.
Those of you that are walking around, walk with some militancy. Come on, you're taking ground. You're not playing with it. Come on, you're taking ground. You're taking authority. Shitando. Oh, come on. Let me show you. Come on. Y'all walk with me. Come on. We're taking ground. We're taking territory. We're declaring the works of the Lord. We're establishing the decrees of God.
I saw expansion coming to the house. In this region, there are not many churches that have apostolic flavor, flair, and anointing. I've never been here. When I came into this city, this is the only building I've ever been to in this city. I've never even stopped to get coffee in this city. But I'm telling you what I know by the Spirit. There may be some run around every once in a while, hiding behind a tree, calling themselves an apostle, but this area is not heavily saturated with apostolic anointing. So when this house says we're going to be that apostolic house, we're going to be that kingdom embassy, that means the hits from hell are all targeted against this house. God wants this house to be a beacon of light in this region, a center, a hub, an apostolic stronghold for the kingdom of God. But it's going to take maturity and growth so that he can put the weight of that mantle and mandate upon the house. The house has to expand. It has to. It has to grow. Those of you that are here, that have been fed and been nurtured, you've got to become the leadership to help birth those that are about to come into the house. As I sat in that seat, while we worshiped, The Lord opened my eyes in the spirit and I saw the demonic prince that sits over this region. I saw him. And I saw him sitting over the city. And you know what he does? He steals dreams. That's what he does. He spies over this city and looks for people that are in motion for divine purpose and destiny, and then he launches an attack to snatch it. So you're contending with something that says every time you move forward an inch, I'm going to snatch them back a mile. That's what you contend with. So that's why it seems like your lives are so unsettled at times. It seems like you just can't make ends meet and you just don't get a permanency and a stability to what you're trying to do. It's a prince in the atmosphere, which is why we had to enter into high praise and high worship to engage the heaven so that we could subdue his power and authority. I saw the Lord blanketing. Y'all got a couple of other things out here, but that's the one that he showed me. I saw the Lord blanketing this area where this church is with a field of light. Apostle, God's giving you a season of momentum. You're about to build. Watch this. You're about to build. You're going to build the people. You're going to build your programs. You're going to build the areas of your ministry. You are going to put everything in place, everything aligned from the bottom all the way to the top. And God is going to give you a season of reprieve where you get to do this without a lot of wrestle. You're going to do it without a lot of opposition from the enemy. That's what that force field that I saw coming over here. During this season, watch this, anything, anyone that needs to be weeded out, change, check, move, put down, whatever, this is the season of grace that God is giving you to do it, because when he pulls back that force field, he's going to present you to the region, and at that time, you just, it's too much of a liability for anybody to be out of place once that season is up. The Lord showed me that he's giving you divine revelation. Watch this, because I'm looking at you and I'm seeing questions, but God is going to dry up the questions and he's releasing strategic apostolic revelation and wisdom. And you are about to build this house. I'm talking about, you thought you built it up until this point. You thought that you put things in place. Watch what God is about to uncap in your understanding. And strategically, you are going to build and things are going to be in place. Watch this. Once you built and established it according to this revelation, the glory is going to come upon the house. Glory is not just mist. Glory is wealth. Glory is splendor. Glory is influence. Glory is affluence. So when the glory comes upon the house, that means that every system and sphere in this entire territory is going to be impacted by this house. So that means government officials are going to begin to look towards this house for things that they need. Because that's how it should be in an apostolic house. It means that they're going to call you to get counsel for how they need to run the city in the area, because they see the glory of the Lord. See, we always said, Jesus said, he won't share his glory with no man. Where is that in the Bible? John 17 says, I've given them the glory that you've given me. He puts his glory on us. He's not intimidated by us walking in splendor. He's not intimidated by us walking in what he walked in. Amen. So he's going to put glory on you. Your voice, like a trumpet, is about to be set to the nation. God is going to give you, watch this, I see it. He's going to give you voice into different realms. There are going to be different leaders from significant, if you will, ministries around the nation that are going to call. And you're going to go in there. And with apostolic precision, you're going to cut cancers out of ministries. You're going to apply the word of the Lord to the very area that is the most infirm and weak in the ministries, and you will save ministries. You will save marriages. You will save families because of what God is about to thrust you into. So this is the season for this house to pray. It is the season for this house to cover the woman of God. It is the season for the Levites to dance and the minstrels to play and the psalmists to sing and to keep the atmosphere of heaven high in the house. to keep the high praises of God in your mouth, because they become the sword of the Lord that cuts asunder everything that opposes the move of God. There's a revival, elder, that's about to come. Watch this. It's a revival of God's power. God is going to put you all on a season of laying on your faces before God in here. Extended. I see an extended season of fasting and prayer. It's going to span weeks. People are going to come in shifts. They're going to come in shifts. I'm looking at it. It's unfolding right before me. And you're going to pray. And you're going to lay before the Lord. And you are going to birth a move of God into the earth. I mean a move of the Spirit. There are prophetic songs that are going to be released here. I hope you record every song that is sang here prophetically. There are prophetic songs that are going to be released from this house that are literally going to become the sound for this next move in the nations. They'll have to be produced. They'll have to be recorded. People have counted you guys out. I'm just going to be finished with this. People have counted you guys out. They counted you out. But God has never counted you out. There's not one thing that has ever transpired in this house that God did not have foreknowledge of. So be at peace and realize that your destiny is still ahead.
Right there. Right there.
In the book of Jeremiah, it talks about that I know the plans that I have for you. God knows the very plans that he has in store for you. Even though a lot of evil thoughts may come to your mind, or even words that people spoke ill about you, you may look at yourself and say, I can't because of my age. But you can. Jeremiah was a youth. And God has called you not contingent on your age or your gender, but it's because of the mandate that's on your life. It's because of the ministry that's locked up inside of you. So we're going to talk today. I have with me right over here, Apostle Randall, and his beautiful wife is over here, Pastor Autumn. And they're here with me all the way from Connecticut. And then I have my wonderful son and daughter. They're from Connecticut. They're actually with their ministry. They help the ministry. And this is Minister Capers, Elder-elect, and also Minister Tanya. And she's so glad to be with us today. But I'm so glad that you tuned in with us today. And we're going to discuss, they're going to share with you a little bit about their testimonies, what brought them to the Lord, and how they moved to this dimension of fulfilling, of working towards their ministry, their passion. They'd share a little bit about their passion. Because many times people ask the question, Do you really like what you do? Do you, you know, how do you keep doing it? You can't do it. You can't continue to do it if there's no passion. You know, it has to be a passion. And when God touches you, something miraculous happens. Listen. So, Apostle Randall, tell me a little bit about your ministry. How did you come into the fold of Christ? When did you receive Christ in your life? And from that point, how has he affected your life?
Okay, well, I received the Lord when I was 7 years old. That was the time that I officially went to the altar and gave my life to the Lord. But before then, my mom always reared me with the understanding of the fact that I had a divine purpose, I had a divine calling on my life, and that there was just something that God expected out of my life, and that one day I would have to give that completely to him. From my earliest memories, my mom would read the Bible to me, just literally starting, you know, at the book of Genesis, and every night she read a little portion of the scripture just to instill that in my understanding. And as I grew, there was just this sense that told me that God was with me and that he had a divine plan for my life. And so as I grew, you know, my life was not unlike most teenagers, most adolescents. Wow. You know, you get pulled into various directions, you know, into the world. You feel like you need to go and experiment and things like that. But even through that process, there was always the awareness of the hand of the Lord upon my life. And so as I begin to grow in an understanding of who he was, from, you know, being in church and being in Sunday school, things of that nature, when I grew in that understanding, yeah, I was able to make an informed decision that I wanted what God had for me, as opposed to, you know, what I wanted for myself or what peer pressure or society was trying to tell me that I needed to have. And I you know, wow, said that yes to the Lord, and then the process just began to unfold.
Wow, that is so awesome. Now, that's so unlike me. When I wasn't raised in a church, and I mean, this is so encouraging because that lets me know that my prayers, that my kids can be used at a young age. But I mean, that's so encouraging. I wasn't raised in a church. I was like in the clubs, I was in gangs, I was like the worst of the worst. I always say I was the worst sinner. So just to know that God can keep you is a testimony. You don't have to do what everyone else is doing. You don't have to have bad things happen to you for to have a testimony. Your testimony can be that God preserved you, that God kept you, that God ministered to you in your youth. He says 7 years old, he went to the altar. That is awesome. So I want to hear from Elder. Tell me about how you came into contact with the Lord, how you came to meet God, and the experience. Let me just, I'm getting a little excited here. When I came, I didn't know the Bible. I didn't know none of that. But what drew me to God is the power of God. I experienced the power of God. Like, he came in and he started breaking stuff in my life. And I just was like, wow, I was totally amazed. Wow. I had such a strong visitation. He would show me things. He would tell me things. And the faith that he has given me even then was so great. And I would just believe him for it and then see it manifested. So it was just through the miraculous power of Jesus Christ. You can experience the presence of God. I mean, you can put your hands on it. You may not know the word like me. I was unsure, and now, as I have grown in ministry, it lets me know you need the presence of God even the more. No matter how much word you have, you still need the presence of God. It's not enough just to have word, but not have revelation, not have the apostolic anointing, not have the presence of God. So that's a little bit about me, but I want to hear about you.
Well, for me, I was 22 years old when I gave my life fully to the Lord. Awesome. I was coming in throughout my years growing up as a child with my grandmother teaching us Bible study every Saturday, going to church every Sunday. Wow. But it really connected with me at the age of 22. I had two kids prior to giving my life to Christ. And the thing that I believe that really drove me outside of my grandmother's prayers was some of my experience that I was going through. I just pretty much got fed up with, like, trying to hang out, trying to stand on the corners with friends, going to the club, wow. and I didn't find it was never fulfilling to me. Mm. So after a while with people ministering to me and speaking into my life about encouraging me about coming to church, mm-hmm. well, I kind of like took another route and was just like, let me just try it.
Right.
Let me just try it. So from there, I went to church and just was like, you know what? Let me try this thing. Because everything else is not working in my life the way I want it to. Mm. So through that, through the trials also that I was going through mm-hmm. with my girlfriend at the time, who is uh-huh. now my wife, you know, no. I decided to give Christ a try because everything else was not working for me. So from wow. there on, ever since then, and I'm glad that I did that.
Wonderful.
It's been a complete difference, turnaround in our lives.
Wow. God is so fulfilling. Yes. I mean, I had so much stuff. I've been across the country, traveling, all that. And nothing brings me peace, contentment, like Jesus Christ. He will fill every void, any need that you have. If you get that close and talk to Him and develop a relationship, He'll meet every one of your needs. You have to trust Him. What you're praying and believing God for, stand on it. Watch what God can do. Your back doesn't have to be against the wall for God to move in your life. You don't have to wait till you get old and feel like that's the only time God can use you. God can use you in your youth. So I pray that you are encouraged today by these men of God. We're going to hear a response by Pastor Autumn tonight. And I just want you to just listen carefully of what she's going to share with you, her experience and how she came to know Christ as her Lord and Savior.
Amen. Well, growing up, I basically went to church with my grandmother and wasn't saved. I didn't get saved until my late teen years. Actually, my husband, Apostle Furlow, had a prayer group ministry, and as a young teenager, I joined that prayer group, and that's actually when my salvation process began. So
wow.
it's just an encouragement to the teens and young people out there to connect with someone that's going to be a positive influence, a mentor, or something like that, to connect to the right people, and
Amen.
Basically it would, you know, be a starting point to help you with your destiny and God's will and vision for your life.
Awesome.
And thank you for watching the broadcast of Bridge to Destiny with Almitra Murdoch. Empowerment Temple International, located at 59 Blooming Grove Turnpike in New Windsor, New York. Telephone 845-728-2216. Empowerment Temple International, located at 59 Blooming Grove Turnpike in New Windsor, New York. Telephone 845-728-2216. in Barman Temple International, located at 59 Blooming Grove Turnpike in New Windsor, New York. Telephone.